Greetings and welcome to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California. I am Bill Grant, Chair of the Health and Medicine Member-Led Forum of the Commonwealth Club. It is now my pleasure to introduce our distinguished speaker, Tom Debley. Tom is the founding director of Kaiser Permanente's Heritage Resources Department, a program that preserves and shares the history of Kaiser Permanente. He and his staff work closely with medical historians and various academic and historical institutions. They are also a partner organization with the Rosie the Riveter World War II Homefront National Historical Park in Richmond, California. And I think they have a representative of that organization here today. A site of the historical Henry J. Kaiser shipyard where Dr. Sidney R. Garfield built the first civilian medical care program on the home front of World War II. Debley had a previous distinguished career in public affairs at the University of California on the Berkeley campus, at Hastings College of the Law, and UC's Office of the President. Before that, Debley worked for many years with an award-winning newspaper reporter, as an award-winning newspaper reporter, photographer, and editor. His latest project, of course, is the book he has authored that is his topic for tonight, The Story of Dr. Sidney R. Garfield, the Visionary Who Turned Sick Care into Health Care. Tom follows in the footsteps of Garfield, who spoke to the Commonwealth Club in June 1945 on topics related to tonight's talk. And now, Tom Debley.
Well, thank you very much, Bill. It's a pleasure to be here. And before I begin, I would like to, if she doesn't mind, introduce somebody because she's a distinguished guest tonight, and that is the representative of the Rosie the Riveter World War II Homefront National Historical Park, Betty Reed Soskin, who is, some say, thank you. Some say Betty is the oldest park ranger in the United States. That's not true. She's the most experienced. But she actually worked in the Kaiser, in the shipyards, and where that park site is, during World War II. So welcome, Betty. I'd like to begin tonight with a quote from the Lair News Hour of August 12th. They did a 10-minute segment on healthcare reform. And they opened with this quote from President Obama. So it was a clip of the president saying, there are examples of how we can make the entire healthcare system more efficient. What works? The Mayo Clinic, the Cleveland Clinic, Geisinger, Kaiser Permanente. There are health systems around the country that actually have costs that are as much as 20% or 30% below the national average and higher quality. What is it they are doing differently from other systems? What they are doing, added correspondent Betty Ann Bowser, is providing excellent care at a low cost through an integrated system where doctor's visits, tests, surgery, hospital care, the works are all done under one roof. Well, more than 70 years ago now, at the site of the construction site for Grand Coulee Dam up in eastern Washington State, Dr. Sidney R. Garfield was looking things over, trying to see if he wanted to get in cahoots with Henry J. Kaiser, and decided that he would join forces with Henry Kaiser. And later he said this, here was the opportunity to get a group practice of specialists together in one location, as we had dreamed about, with everything we needed for good care under one roof. He later explained this in more detail to a meeting of the American Medical Association during World War II, saying that his idea involved three major principles: prepayment, group medical practice, and adequate facilities. And he said, by adequate facilities, I mean bringing the doctor's offices, the hospital, the laboratory, and x-rays together under one roof, geared to achieve the utmost in efficiency and economy. And indeed, he actually spoke to the Commonwealth Club on two occasions. And on March 22, 1945, his topic was a workable health plan on the basis of the Permanente experience, at about the time he and Henry Kaiser were putting forth their first plan for nationwide prepaid health care. I found the NewsHour segment fascinating in light of the research I had done to write this biography, in that during that 10-minute segment, there was not a single idea talked about that was substantially different from what Sidney Garfield talked about in the 1930s. So I hope it's obvious at this point that I felt there was a need to bring this man's story to biographical form, because that had never been done, and he was being forgotten in terms of his partnership with Henry J. Kaiser. So as I talk about him tonight, I wanted to set a little bit more contemporary context. A couple of weeks ago, a professor down in Arizona wrote to a colleague, a friend of mine, who forwarded the letter to me, and in it he explained that he had read the book and closed it and packaged it up and sent it off to his, as he described it, his blue dog representative in Congress, with a note saying, "You will learn that the debate we are engaged in now has gone on for 80 or 90 years, and we seem further from a solution now than when Garfield figured out how to deliver health care at least three generations ago." Well, indeed, since the early 20th century, we've been engaged in this debate about how to bring comprehensive health care within the reach of all Americans. And except for incremental improvements, we have failed to achieve that goal. And my subject is this physician who entered the profession during those early debates. He came to believe that health care should be a right. And I think of him not as a policy wonk, because he wasn't, but as this physician dedicated, I like to say, to daily reform, because he was constantly experimenting with ideas, really believed in what we today call evidence-based medicine, and day in and day out, week in and week out, during the Great Depression and World War II and beyond, he was working literally in the trenches of healthcare. One last bit of context. Back in 2002, Jonathan Engel, a professor of health policy at Seton Hall University, wrote a book titled Doctors and Reformers, Discussion and Debate Over Health Policy, 1925 to 1950. Among his many topics, he comments on the historic conflict we Americans have over wanting to have health care for everyone and being, as he puts it, fearful of what we will lose ourselves. Time and again, Professor Engel wrote, "We have rejected any substantial reform in which we feared loss of control over choice and access." This was true during the heady debates of 1925 to 1950. It remains true today. Well, it was during those heady debates that Sidney Garfield got started. In 1933, he set up a small hospital in the Mojave Desert near a little town called Desert Center. He wanted to earn his living just out of residency, taking care of the men who were building the Colorado River Aqueduct. The location was best described by one writer from back in that era who described it as a, quote, "hot, dusty region never meant by God for human activity or habitation." Today, California State Historical Marker number 992 marks what Sidney Garfield did there. First thing he did was went broke. Fee-for-service didn't work. Insurance companies discounted his fees. The men didn't have enough money to pay for personal care. It was basically insurance compensation care, workers' compensation type care. And it was there that Sidney Garfield, when approached by two gentlemen from Industrial Indemnity Insurance Company based here in San Francisco, suggested prepayment. And Garfield embraced the idea of prepayment and prevention in a way that reversed the medical economics of the era. Instead of being paid only when a man was injured or sick, he now was paid regardless, and he was able to expand, build two more hospitals, and he had a financial incentive to keep people from being injured and keeping them well. So he began to focus on prevention and particularly on safety engineering. It was when he finished that job that he was introduced to the Kaisers and went up to Grand Coulee Dam. And it was at Grand Coulee Dam that he added to the principles of prepayment and prevention the ideas of group medical practice, facilities under one roof, and a family plan. He later called what he did at Grand Coulee his final dress rehearsal for the home front of World War II, and what he did at the Kaiser shipyards here on San Francisco Bay, as well as up in Vancouver, Washington, and Portland, Oregon on the Columbia River, and at Fontana in Southern California, where Henry Kaiser built the first steel mill west of the Rockies to produce steel to build the ships. It's quite remarkable when we look back, and there's a whole chapter on the home front in the book, but when we look back at what Garfield and his colleagues did. In 18 months, they built four hospitals. They created the largest civilian medical care program of the home front and in American history up to that point. After the war, Garfield would be accused of pushing socialized medicine and at one point even threatened with the loss of his medical license. But during the war, people did not attack him because it wasn't popular to attack people who were helping to win the war. In addition, his ideas and the way he developed them and implemented them, along with a charitable response to his critics, his partnership with Henry Kaiser, and his sheer perseverance made Sidney Garfield unstoppable. Looking back, presidents from Franklin Roosevelt to Richard Nixon to Bill Clinton and now Barack Obama have looked at his model for ideas about how to achieve health care for all. Lots of things have gone right and lots of things have gone wrong in that process, and I'll just mention one very briefly. The HMO Act of 1973 was said to have been modeled after Kaiser Permanente. True, to a point, the problem was that by the time the model was developed, the legislation was passed, and President Nixon signed it, Kaiser Permanente didn't qualify as an HMO. I won't go into details about that, but eventually that was all remedied. So there were certain aspects of the model that were left out. But as for Sidney Garfield, I look at him as a really a classic American story. He was a doer. He was passionate about his calling, and he was determined in his quest. What we found, I found in the research, was that over and over again, whatever obstacles were thrown in his way, he just found some way to move beyond them. And like his ideas or not, he and Henry Kaiser achieved something quite remarkable in that they have brought affordable health care to literally millions upon millions upon millions of people since they opened to the public in 1945. I don't think there are two individuals in American history who have brought that much health care directly to that many people. And that's not to say that there aren't a lot of other people who are doing remarkable things and who have done wonderful things. But I wanted people to know more about Sidney Garfield, and so that's why I wrote the book, to try to remedy the sort of the lack of knowledge of Dr. Garfield. His is a fairly typical immigrant story. His parents, Isaac and Bertha, were both Russian Jewish immigrants in the late 19th century. They came separately to the United States. They met, they fell in love, they were married. Isaac was an entrepreneurial door-to-door salesman, which was not an uncommon way for immigrants to make a living in that era. And soon he was able to open his own gentleman's clothing store in Elizabeth, New Jersey. And Sidney Garfield was born there in 1906. He and his sister grew up in an apartment over that store. Sidney was brilliant. He was entrepreneurial, like his father. He was persistent. He was stubborn. His father nicknamed him Mule. He was also self-confident. His parents devoted themselves to trying to prepare him for life in their adopted country. His scholastic record was outstanding. His parents wanted for him a career that would assure social respectability and financial security. Well, for his part, Garfield made what he thought was a good choice. He had become fascinated with American cities and the skyscraper. He thought, I would like to be an architect or an engineer. And indeed, decades later, working with hospital designs, he was quite the follower of Lewis Sullivan's form follows function philosophy in his designs. But while in high school, Isaac and Bertha had other ideas. Without consulting their son, they informed him one night that he would take a state examination for a scholarship to Rutgers University. They further informed him that he would thus be able to win a free medical education and become a doctor. A rather lengthy and tearful argument, according to his sister, ensued, with Sidney eventually reduced to tears and blubbering, "But I can't stand the sight of blood." But given the era and given the culture, he acceded to his parents' insistence, and out of 60 students who qualified to take the exam, only two passed, one of them Sidney Garfield. He went on to earn his medical degree from the University of Iowa Medical School in 1928, and from there goes to Chicago's highly regarded Michael Reese Hospital, and he does a one-year internship there. Unfortunately, nothing has survived that we've been able to locate so far that tells us about his experiences there, but I think it's likely, based on other things that happened later, that there had to have been some significant impact on him, particularly given his Jewish immigrant roots and his later egalitarian views about health care being available to everyone. Michael Reese was named for a 19th century Jewish immigrant. Reese amassed a fortune in real estate, and after his death, his heirs funded the construction of this hospital. And among other things, they stipulated that this hospital serve all Chicago residents, especially the underserved, regardless of race, creed, or nationality. Michael Reese was also an exemplary teaching and research medical center, values that Garfield insisted be embedded into Kaiser Permanente when he and Henry Kaiser founded it. The physical space, too, must have had some impact on Garfield. We know he loved the idea of being an architect. We know from his later history of remarkable things he did in hospital designs. And as it turns out, the Michael Reese Hospital has been described as a gem of the Chicago School of Architecture that one writer says exudes the influence of Lewis Sullivan. So I speculate, because we don't have the firm documentary evidence, that this place must have had some impact on Garfield, particularly with what happens next. He next gets a one-year internship at Los Angeles County General Hospital. The year is 1929. We all know what happened then. The Great Depression is underway. And here, the record is very clear about things that happened that influenced him and his desire to try new things. He spends that year and decides during that time that he wants to become a surgeon, and so he is accepted into a three-year surgical residency. So he's there from 1930 to 1933. Well, remarkable things are happening at that time. The county hospital is struggling, trying to figure out ways to deal with the increasing numbers of people in that desperate time of the Great Depression. And they actually produce some rather grand experiments in what becomes known in that era as social medicine. There's also a brand new hospital being built. It's 19 stories high. It's right next to where Sidney Garfield is working. It's billed as the largest hospital in the world when actress Mary Pickford lays the cornerstone in 1930. LA County at that time has an established teaching hospital relationship with the USC School of Medicine, today's Keck School, and Sidney Garfield later becomes the first surgical teaching resident for the USC surgical program. So we're seeing things emerge there very similar to what Garfield would have experienced at Michael Reese. Indeed, over the entrance of the new hospital, the mission of community service is literally carved in stone. Erected, and this is still there, erected by the citizens of the County of Los Angeles to provide hospital care for the acutely ill and suffering, to whom the doctors of the attending staff give their services without charge in order that no citizen of the county shall be deprived of health for lack of such care and services. The architecture itself is fascinating. One health scholar wrote about the design and how it seemed to echo the dialogue over the concept of social medicine at the time. The very architecture, she says, is a tangible transmitter of the optimistic culture of American life, of the deepest aspirational principle behind the construction of the systems of healthcare. One cannot underestimate the impact of this environment on Dr. Garfield, who summed it up himself most succinctly some years later with the very short sentence, "We grew up at the county hospital." This same sentiment is reflected later by Dr. Jack Smiley, who was another famous figure in prepaid group medical practice and joined the Permanente Medical Group here in Northern California, and who also trained at LA County Hospital only a little bit later than Dr. Garfield. As he put it in a history that he wrote, the socially responsive hospital setting where patients were treated without consideration of payment was formative in Garfield's development. The young physicians absorbed a sense of medicine as a form of social practice that was part and parcel not only of Los Angeles County, but of America itself during the Depression era. These young doctors were learning not only from each other and from teams of physicians at Los Angeles County, but also from the philosophy of social responsibility that animated a great public hospital at a time of economic stress. As one of Garfield's fellow residents, Dr. Ray Kay, who also joined forces with Dr. Garfield and founded the Southern California Permanente Medical Program. And he said it very well in terms of how much impact the Great Depression and what was happening had on them. He wrote at one point, "We were at a point of social change where the Great Depression and the innovative policies of the Roosevelt administration began to emphasize the need to help those who could not help themselves. So our thinking and our actions were a product of the times." Well, the other thing that happens with this awakening of these young idealistic physicians is critical to what happens later. Dr. Garfield became fascinated with the academic and teaching hospital setting, and he saw that as a model that could be used as a basis for how to deliver medical care. He loved the highly collegial environment, this idea of everybody learning from each other. The hospital, of course, was an exciting place in that era. full of bright, mostly young, idealistic physicians grappling literally with life and death issues every single day during the Depression. In the conversations they had with each other, Dr. Kay recalls, he said, we started thinking, wouldn't it be wonderful if we could really practice as a doctor with a group of doctors where you could share knowledge and share experience and share patients and where you could take care of people with no economic blocks. So this is where they begin to dream. I read that quote from Sidney Garfield earlier where he talked about Grant Cooley and as we had dreamed. There's another history that's been done in Southern California which actually has a chapter about them calling them the dreamers. Now, I think interestingly, these young physicians also had to have a sense, Dr. Garfield had to have the sense that they were going to be up against some powerful political forces for entertaining such ideas, let alone creating such a system of medicine. I think forgotten in much of American debate was that in 1932, there was this group called the Committee on the Costs of Medical Care. It was a blue ribbon group. There were 48 outstanding physicians, economists, and other healthcare professionals who issued a report about how to reform the delivery of medical care. Now, the chair of this group was Dr. Ray Lyman Wilbur. Dr. Wilbur was past president of the American Medical Association. He was former dean of the Stanford University School of Medicine. Later, he became president of Stanford University. This group, at a time when solo practice was the dominant practice, recommended that doctors organize themselves into multi-specialty group medical practices. They recommended that physicians begin to focus as much on preventing illness as taking care of the sick. They recommended finding mechanisms to level the economic playing field, such as prepayment. And they recommended that doctors find a way to more broadly share and coordinate the delivery of care, the idea that Garfield describes as facilities under one roof. Well, the reaction to this was what, in light of what's gone on ever since, you might expect. Incitement to revolution, declared the American Medical Association. Socialized medicine, came the cry from other parts of society. And here we've got Sidney Garfield, who embraces these ideas. And I think there's lore that he invented some of these ideas, and he didn't. That's one of the points I try to make, that his genius was not in inventing prevention or prepayment or group medical practice, but that he figured out how to assemble them in a way that they worked quite well for Henry Kaiser at Grand Coulee Dam, and then they moved these to the home front of World War II, where they were equally successful on a much larger scale. In Garfield, in 1945, when he was giving a lot of talks, including the one I mentioned here at the Commonwealth Club, and he gave a talk to a group of community physicians up in Portland, Oregon, which was really the first time that we have a record of him sort of laying out all of his ideas. And it's so clear how important he saw the academic teaching hospital as a foundation. As he said then, it has always been a paradox that group practice is the method used to teach medicine of the highest type. All university medical schools are group practice operations. Yet the individual physician is taught to go into solo practice. Group practice is essential because as medical knowledge increases in mass and complexity, no one doctor can learn the entire field. That actually was almost identical to an interview in that Lair NewsHour report from somebody from the Cleveland Clinic. So 50 years later, we're still there are physicians still trying to get that point across. The group practice, Dr. Garfield said, produces both quality and economy. quality because the doctors participating are specialists, because consultation is easy, and because of the stimulus resulting from working with well-trained physicians in various fields. Economy results from the use of common facilities, records, office space, and equipment, as well as the elimination of the wasted time of travel from place to place. But perhaps most important was Dr. Garfield's dedication to the idea of preventing illness. And it was here that Garfield, who had this wonderful way of just putting something into a few words, summed up his point of view in 1945, saying, "The people of this country don't want to get sick." Well, a few years ago, the late Gerard Peel, longtime publisher of Scientific American, summed up the contributions of Dr. Garfield and Henry Kaiser with similar brevity. He was asked when they did a retrospective exhibit at the Oakland Museum of California on Henry Kaiser. They asked a number of people to just spontaneously list what they thought were some of the most important contributions. And he said of the two men that they filled, quote, "the full prescription from the 1932 report from the Committee on the Costs of Medical Care." Well, I take Garfield's story from that Depression era through World War II. And during World War II, it becomes clear that his passion has now shifted from being a surgeon, although he never gives up surgery completely, but to building this system of care. That was his, and when you talk to people who worked with him during World War II, you get that sense that people were really pulling together for a mission to help support winning the war. Now, Garfield's precise work in the shipyards was actually quite unexpected. He had left Grand Coulee when the dam was completed, went back to Los Angeles, was teaching at USC Medical School, and Pearl Harbor was bombed. He signed up for a hospital unit that was established using a lot of physicians from USC, and they're ready to go off to war when he gets a call from a man named Clay Bedford, who was running the Kaiser shipyard in Richmond, and Bedford asked him if he would come and help them, and he said, "Well, I can't, I'm in the Army now." When you're shipping out, well, in a month, he said, "Well, come for 30 days and help us, advise us." And his main contact with the Kaiser executives was a man named A.B. Ordway, and in the middle of that month, Ordway disappears, and nobody can tell Sidney Garfield where Ordway is. It's as though he's just vanished from the face of the earth. Well, it turns out he was on a secret mission to Washington, D.C., and returns with a letter from President Roosevelt informing Dr. Garfield he was no longer in the Army, he was needed for the production war. Well, Garfield's pace was feverish. The rolls of potential patients grew first by hundreds, then thousands, then tens of thousands. As you may recall from that history of the war, people came by car, by train, by bus, for jobs in the shipyards over in Richmond. And Garfield, of course, suddenly has this great need for doctors, nurses, pharmacists, lab technicians, ambulance drivers. He needs to build first aid stations, emergency rooms, the four hospitals. And he completes that, and his executive assistant, Sally Bulletin, who is still alive, and I had the wonderful opportunity of interviewing her, she recalled that Sidney Garfield never had time to claim a desk or an office for most of World War II. When he was in town, he mostly used her desk. And she recalls one day, she shared a letter with us, which was fascinating in terms of her understanding that something big was happening. The letter was to a friend, and she wrote, "'Tis like heady wine to be even a small dot in this organization," adding of Garfield, "his amazing vitality, abilities, and many accomplishments are still, after 3 years, astounding to me. To try and keep up with him is almost too much." And she recalled one day when he was in Oakland, shuttling up and down the West Coast, And they had a particularly difficult surgery that was taking place. And he was, by all accounts, an outstanding surgeon. And so they summoned Dr. Garfield, and he goes off, and she says, "The next thing I knew, Sid was upstairs doing the surgery and pulled the man through." When he returned, Bulletin asked him, "Sid, why aren't you practicing surgery with your fantastic capabilities?" And I think this is his response is true of a lot of people on the home front. "There are a lot of fine surgeons," he responded, "but very few people can do what I'm doing now." I actually talked to one of his colleagues, and I said, "What did you guys talk about in terms of these ideas and things?" He said, "Talk? Sonny, we had a war to win. We worked 18 hours a day, and if something worked, we continued doing it. If it didn't work, we stopped doing it." So a lot of this early work was experimental in a sense. The other ingredient that I want to mention from this period, because I think embedded in a lot of the healthcare debate today is, you know, profit, nonprofit. I don't think that that is the issue as much as mission. And these folks were mission driven. And when the Kaiser Foundation was formed in 1942 as the financing structure, it was uncommon for this sort of financing. In fact, Henry Kaiser's lawyer told him that, "I don't think you can do that, Henry." This lawyer's name was Paul Maron. Some of you may remember that name. He was quite famous here in San Francisco. And Henry looked at him and said, "Paul, stop telling me what I can't do and help me figure out how to do what I want to do." And a few months later, papers were filed in Alameda County. But the idea came from this Dr. K. Dr. K, after he finished his residency, he went to work for the dean of the medical school at USC. And the dean had this idea that nonprofit financing was a way to explore for funding medical care. And so Ray K went off around the country, studied things, came back. And when he was shipping out, he and Dr. Garfield had dinner here in San Francisco the night before Dr. K left for Burma, and Dr. K actually suggested this idea of a not-for-profit financing mechanism. Well, other than to say that Dr. Garfield and Henry Kaiser had to withstand allegations, charges of supporting socialized medicine, suffice it to say that they came through that period by the 1950s, had built the largest not-for-profit healthcare delivery system in the country. Those were not easy times. There's actually a former Kaiser aluminum executive who told me that when he was a young salesman in about 1950, early 50s, that he called on Arkansas Power and Light Company and was ushered off the premises with the words, "We don't buy aluminum from communists in California." And he said that was a direct reference to what was going on with the health care. Well, the last part I want to talk about tonight with Dr. Garfield is this post-war period in terms of what happens to him. The organization grows. In the book, you'll find a lot of the detail around this, but the bottom line is it reorganized itself into three distinct entities, the Permanente Medical Groups, the Kaiser Foundation Hospital, and the Kaiser Foundation Health Plan. And in doing so, they structured in a way that there's ever since been this sort of remarkable partnership that goes on, and it very clearly, much of the time, and not so clearly other parts of the time, delineates the authority that's going to be held by the physicians and the authorities that's going to be held by the other two institutions, and it's worked quite well. But this left Sidney Garfield, who had been in charge of everything during and immediately after the war, no longer in charge of everything. As I say, he seems to find this way throughout his life of moving forward, and he now gravitates toward design of hospitals and facilities. So now his avocation of architecture is at the center of his life, and his wartime designs of hospitals brought him quite a bit of national attention for innovations. His post-war work brings him international fame. He builds three hospitals in 1953, or they open three hospitals, one here in San Francisco, one in Walnut Creek, and one in Los Angeles, and they're nicknamed the Dream Hospitals. Dr. Walter C. Alvarez, who was probably America's most famous physician in that era, told the radio broadcaster Lowell Thomas, "A new day has dawned when more brains will go into the design and architecture of a hospital." Newscaster Chet Huntley reported the use of labor-saving devices, the use of light, both natural and artificial, the furnishings, the gadgets, the decor, and the personnel are all combined to make the new Kaiser Foundation Hospital something special. I mention this because I also want to talk about perhaps the most prescient observer, a man named Ed Herlihy, who narrated a Universal International Movie House newsreel titled Dream Hospital. And at one point, he comments about, you're seeing pictures of pneumatic tubes moving things, and his comment is, the patient's record reaches the doctor before the patient does. Well, it was kind of cute the first time I saw it, but as I did the research and began to look at what was happening in the 1950s, what I realized was that Sidney Garfield was now beginning to understand that once you get efficiency in this facilities under one roof, that it's really the moving of medical information that is important. And so within a few years, he starts talking about a concept called total health. And in 1960, he stands up in front of a management group and he says, I want to throw this idea on the table for your consideration. Please accept it in the spirit it is given. It's a controversial idea, but please keep an open mind. It's really time for us to revitalize our plan. I suggest a radical new idea that we stop building hospitals and clinics for sick people. Let's concentrate on adding a brand new type of facility, a new first in the world. Let's conceive of a building for health designed, streamlined, and geared to serve our healthy members. And then he drops the bombshell. Let's use computers. This is 1960. We're talking about gigantic IBM mainframes and punch cards. And he tells them, you know, someday we could have a system where a member could come in for a first visit and all that initial information can be put into a computer. And then over the years, you could add to that. Now, this again was 1960. And during the 1960s, the first modem transmissions of medical information in California history were taking place between San Francisco and Oakland within that Kaiser system. He said he wanted to see high-tech centers focused on prevention and health maintenance. This was before the HMO Act, where every conceivable laboratory, x-ray, EKG, and other tests could be run with advanced new equipment. And to this, let's add health education, and he assigned someone to do a whole research project, which we haven't even begun to truly understand because the papers from that, boxes of them, have just come into our archive, so we haven't even cataloged and gone through all of those yet. Well baby clinics, prenatal clinics, teen clinics, they actually had the first teen medicine clinics in a general population up and running before the first baby boomer turned 13. A place for routine vaccinations and immunizations. And by the early 1970s, Sidney Garfield was leading teams of people, and they actually were starting to build such a system. And it was a long journey to reality. It took 30-plus years to achieve what they're achieving today, which was his vision. But he also predicted that it would take 30 years. The great promise of computers for medicine lies in making an entirely new medical care system possible, he wrote in 1974. Such a new system is just now beginning to emerge from the old. And he actually lays out this vision in a talk to medical students, and we have a recording of that, and I played it once for a group of people working in health IT, including physicians. And when I finished, I asked for questions or comments, and this physician stood up and said, "Well, I don't have a question, but I have a comment. I was in medical school the year he gave that speech. Not that school, but let me tell everybody in this room this. That man was preaching revolution." If you're interested in more detail, he published a paper finally in 1970 in Scientific American titled The Delivery of Medical Care. And it is the most important paper of his career, according to several people who know him and know that literature. And he extends things beyond, as at this point he's talking about a system of healthcare for all, the healthcare as a right. And he predicts in Scientific American beyond Kaiser Permanente that matching the superb technology of present-day medicine with an effective delivery system can raise U.S. medical care to a level unparalleled in the world. The article is considered a classic now in medical literature, and we do republish it once again as Appendix 5 in the book. Well, in conclusion, what, you may ask, was the biggest lesson I took away from researching and writing the story of Dr. Sidney Garfield? Well, I think number one, it was his persistence. Without taking away from others, and certainly Sidney Garfield is not the only person in American medicine in the 20th century to achieve great things, but he dared to embrace new ideas in the 1930s. He dared to put them in place. He stood up to not only allegations of being a socialist and communist, but he was brought up on ethics charges and had to battle through that. The second thing was his daring. I love his daring. There's a point at which he's feeling very low when he's been brought up on these charges, and he actually turns to Dr. Wilbur, who he had, through all of this, he had never met Ray Lyman Wilbur, and he's at a social event. It was here in the city, and he figures, I'm going to bring this up with Dr. Wilbur. And he needs a little courage, so we know he from his own words, that he went to the bar that evening and stiffened his resolve with a couple of extra martinis and went and sort of poured out his story to Dr. Wilbur, who told him, look, you're doing something new. You're doing something good for patients. You're doing something good for doctors. Stop crying about it. Now, if you weren't being criticized, you wouldn't be doing anything great. And people who knew Garfield said the next day his life changed forever. And he no longer was bothered by criticism. He actually embraced criticism. And as he goes along, I love one journalist's description of him in 1962. Dr. Garfield's innovations have been raising the eyebrows and sometimes the hair of traditionalists since the 1930s. And around that same time, he gave a talk to physicians, and he basically talked about the whole idea of evidence-based medicine. Figure out, you know, if you got a new idea, you test it, and when you've tested it, then you propose it. And in that sense, he told them to overcome resistance. First, you must be good. Second, you must be right. Third, you must be strong. In that respect, opposition puts you on your mettle and forces you to perform your task well. I guess now the question is, will we ever see his vision of universal access to affordable, high-quality healthcare come to pass? So let me stop there and take your questions. Are we doing questions from the floor?
All right, a round of applause, I think, for this talk. We're listening to Tom Debley speak about Dr. Sidney Garfield, the visionary who turned sick care into health care and founded the Kaiser Permanente health system. We'll take questions from the microphone over there if you want to start standing over there to ask your questions. I'll ask the first question. If Sidney Garfield were around today, what advice would he give to President Obama and Congress about reforming health care in America today?
Well, I think the advice he would give him, in a sense, has been given to him when we look at some of his comments of looking at this model. But I think the other thing that Sidney Garfield was very good at, and why I say he overcame some of the resistance because of the charity with which he treated his opponents, his accusers. He really did believe that we could create a system using a variety of different models and create a system that was not a government-run system. Now, I know he changed his mind on some of that because we seem to forget that we have this public plan called Medicare, which somehow in the current debate has become a private plan, I think. But I think his advice would be to bring as many parties together, which would fit very well with President Obama's style, to see if we can't come to a consensus. And I personally have become intrigued with the professor who I quoted from Seton Hall University, who talks about the fact that a lot of this is a tension between our desire to want to have health care for everybody, but our fear over what it's going to cost us individually. It's that thing that, if you're familiar with Robert Bellah's work, the great sociologist, that tension between individualism and commitment in America, where we seem to have seesawed back and forth. And I think that's sort of at the center of a lot of our issues around health care. Do we have other questions?
Well, first, thank you very much. The question, just to follow up on your comment about Medicare. So Medicare, if you kind of extrapolate it in a sense from the Kaiser system, the prepayment element are our taxes. And you're dealing with now the population that is not healthy. It is the population that needs the care. Do you have a perspective on why is it that all the polls say that the people who are most against the, or I shouldn't say most, but strongly against the Obama plan are those who are using Medicare?
I think my perspective would echo that of Professor Engel, who there's the fear of what people would lose. Even if there's no evidence that they would lose that, there's the fear. And that fear is a big driver in that. And how we get beyond that, I'm not sure. And somebody has a microphone down here.
Yes. It occurs to me that during his formative years that you've described in the book, that we didn't yet have much established in the way of third-party payers. How would he, or how did he, respond to the emergence of that concept?
Well, he responded to that actually by helping to create it, because when you look at the third-party payer in terms of the employer, that's essentially what Henry Kaiser has created during that era. And if you look back at Henry Kaiser's speeches, he was one of the leading proponents of employer-sponsored health care. His first call for nationwide employer-sponsored health care was in 1942. I think there's some complex personal things with Henry Kaiser that are behind that. His mother, he often described his mother dying in his arms. His father went blind. His wife, Bess, when they were just married, had surgery on a kitchen table. I mean, they were not wealthy people at that time. And he developed this passion about somehow wanting to help people have access to medical care. Now, some scholars have been debating about how far back that goes, but we, in building our archive, we did discover a speech given by his son, Edgar Kaiser, who does confirm in that speech that when he was just a small boy, he and his brother, Henry Jr., that his father would talk about this. So when he became, you know, a powerful, rich industrialist with thousands upon thousands of employees, this is what he saw as a way to create a system. And Sidney Garfield embraced that. Sidney Garfield was about half Henry's age and did come to view Henry not just as a mentor, he at one point described him as a second father. So there was this relationship, and if you know the story of the death of the first Mrs. Kaiser and Sidney's marriage had ended in divorce, and so Henry marries Allie Chester, who is an executive nurse on on Sidney Garfield's staff. She is, by all accounts, a brilliant nurse. And Sidney ends up marrying her sister, so they end up becoming brothers-in-law. So it's a very tangled, interesting personal relationship, which could probably be the subject of another book. Yes.
Listening to this, it sounds like Dr. Garfield was a very vital visionary, almost like an entrepreneurial. Like today, you could totally see him doing .com things or whatever. And his vision and his strength of the daring and stuff sort of pushed, you could almost see him as getting everyone going in one direction, and then he pokes his head up and looks around, like you were talking about the vacuum tubes, and then as soon as they get it in place and everyone's excited, then they want to switch directions because that's almost the past now. And now it's at the point where Kaiser has implemented the medical records, the electronic medical records. And I'm wondering, you know, Dr. Garfield isn't here except as a ghost, and how to continue going forward in that vein of, you know, poking your head up and looking around now that everyone's going in one direction and seeing, well, what's the next direction that we need to think about to go in?
Well, I think my lesson from working on Dr. Garfield's biography is that in any institution at any time, there are visionaries. It's a question of, do you recognize the visionaries? And I think that's the trick. There's a story about Sidney Garfield. His last research project was called the Total Health Study. And he died while that work was being done. And the lore around it was that it died. There were people who were opposed to it. We documented that, and it's in the book, that there were those who said that the organization wanted to kill the project. Well, actually, it turns out that there were some physicians who were upset about the idea. You know, change is hard, and Sidney Garfield always recognized that change was hard, and they were very upset because he wanted to build healthcare teams that involved physicians, and the experimental model that we're working with was a physician and three nurse practitioners. And as one of the people we interviewed said, that the issue wasn't the project, the issue was physicians who were opposed to the project because they didn't want a physician and three nurse practitioners, they wanted four physicians. So there was this tension, and then I had the just remarkable experience of my personal physician went off into a specialty, and so I thought, well, we'll try somebody else out, and ended up with this physician who, as it turns out, worked on the Total Health Project. And I said, you know, you're in our archive. I am. And I explained, and he sort of lit up like a Christmas tree, and he started talking about Total Health, and he said, that's who we are today. But in the conversations, what was intriguing was his description of Sidney Garfield. He said, you know, Sidney Garfield was the principal investigator, but what he did mostly was he'd show up at our meetings, and he'd start talking to us, and pretty soon we felt like we were standing up, looking out over the horizon, and then he'd say, get back to work and leave. And I think that's that visionary spirit and recognizing that, because clearly he had, within the organization, he had people who opposed his new ideas. And I often say to groups inside of the organization when I give talks, who in this room has that idea of what's next? Because that's, I think, the biggest lesson from Sidney Garfield is that he was never satisfied. Once something was in place, he was looking out for something else. And we recently found a large box of his, what they're called, cron files, his correspondence files. But these were fascinating, and as I leaf through them, each thing in that file was an article, a flyer, something talking about something new. And you see these things day after day where he's circled it, and he's written to his secretary, get me a copy of this, order information about this. And so he was constantly, what that box really told us was he was constantly scanning the horizon. He was always looking for new ideas. And that's, I guess, the last thing I'd say about that is is that that's what I find remarkable about, pardon me, the visionary, is that this stuff isn't just popping up out of the head necessarily. It's this constantly scanning and saying, well, if I put this together with this, we'll get this result. Let's test it. And part of that spirit came from Henry Kaiser. I don't know if how many here have heard about the Hobby Lobby, which was in Emeryville. And it was this place where basically Henry Kaiser or somebody else would have an idea, and he'd say, let's build a prototype. And by that afternoon or evening, they were already at work on it. And some of them were great successes. Some of them, like his water-powered dishwasher, the first time they tested it in front of people, it broke every single dish. So, and the same is said of Sidney Garfield, that his head was a font of ideas, including a few duds along the way. Yes?
So innovation and education and collegiality sounds like they were really very important to Sidney Garfield. Why do you think it is that the Kaiser system, and I work for Kaiser, so I'm not disparaging them at all, but why do you think that the Kaiser system has not been very productive in terms of publishing in the literature or coming up with surgical innovations or new drugs or what have you?
Well, one, I think that it is continued to be very innovative. I mean, its research arms are huge. The number of papers and the number of institutions that their division of research here, as well as the one in Portland that serves Portland and Hawaii, have produced vast amounts of literature over the decades. And I think with any large organization, it's hard to often see what's going on, but clearly the organization is at the forefront of the electronic medical record. And if you've ever used the system, if you're a Kaiser member and you can order your prescriptions and look up information and make appointments and all of that. We did an oral history with one of the people who was at the center of that initial work, and we're talking about a small group of people who had a card table and a borrowed PC back in the late 80s, and they were in health education, and they decided, hey, what if? And today they have created a whole arm of the organization, which is one of the reasons my department exists, is to try to capture that, because I think it, in many respects, I think you could say it has become an organization that, like all big organizations, can plod along in a lot of areas, but the innovation that's popping up here and there, their ability to track medical information, I've forgotten now the name of the drug that was taken off the market, that came out of, pardon? Yeah, Vioxx. And that whole thing started because Kaiser Permanente researchers began to notice anomalies and said, wait a minute, something's going on here we need to pay attention to. Well, thank you very much, all of you. Okay.
Our thanks to our distinguished speaker, Tom Debley, for his comments here today. We also thank our audiences here, as well as those listening to this recording. And now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, commemorating its 106th year of enlightened discussion, is adjourned.